gather at your table as we listen to your word. Help us know, O God, your presence. Let our hearts and minds be stirred. Nourish us with sacred story till we claim it as our own. Teach us through this holy banquet how to make love's victory known. Turn our worship into witness in the sacraments of life. Send us forth to love and serve you, bringing peace where there is strife. Give us, Christ, your great compassion to forgive as you forgave. May we still behold your image in the world you died to save.
Let hearts that seek the Lord rejoice. Turn to the Lord and his strength. Constantly seek his face. Constantly seek his face. And let us begin as we begin all things. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And with your spirit.
We gather today in this holy place to give glory and thanks to our God who created us. We also come here to encounter the very living presence of Jesus in his word and in the sacrament of this altar. And we also encounter him in one another. So let's take a moment and welcome each other into the risen body of his church. Brothers and sisters, let us acknowledge our sins and so prepare ourselves to celebrate the sacred mysteries.
You have sent the healer, contrite of heart. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
You came to call sinners. Christ, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
You are seated at the right hand of the Father to intercede for us. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
May Almighty God have mercy on us, forgive us our sins, and bring us to everlasting life.
Amen. Glory to God in the highest, and on earth thanks for your great glory, Lord God, heavenly King. O God, almighty Father, Lord Jesus Christ, only begotten Son, Lord God, Lamb of God, Son of the Father, take away the sins of the world. Have mercy on us. You take away the sins of the world. Receive our prayer. You are seated at the right hand of the Father. Have mercy on us. Have mercy on us. For you alone are the Holy One. You alone are the Lord. You alone are the Most High, Jesus Christ. Amen. Amen.
Let us pray. Almighty ever-living God, increase our faith, hope, and charity. Make us love what you command, so that we may merit what you promise. Through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God forever and ever. Amen.
A reading from the book of Sirach. The Lord is a God of justice who knows no favorites. Though not unduly partial toward the weak, yet he hears the cry of the oppressed. The Lord is not deaf to the wail of the orphan, nor to the widow when she pours out her complaint. The one who serves God willingly is heard. His petition reaches the heavens. The prayer of the lowly pierces the clouds. It does not rest till it reaches its goal, nor will it withdraw till the Most High responds, judges justly, and affirms the right. And the Lord will not delay.
The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Crushed in spirit, he saves. The Lord virgin hem.
The Lord is the cry of the poor.
A reading from the second letter of St. Paul to Timothy. Beloved, I am already being poured out like a libation, and the time of my departure is at hand. I have competed well. I have finished the race. I have kept the faith. From now on, the crown of righteousness awaits me, which the Lord, the just judge, will award to me on that day. And not only to me, but to all who have longed for his appearance. At my first defense, no one appeared on my behalf, but everyone deserted me. May it not be held against them. But the Lord stood by me and gave me strength, so that through me the proclamation might be completed, and all the Gentiles might hear it. And I was rescued from the lion's mouth. The Lord will rescue me from every evil threat and will bring me safe to his heavenly kingdom. To him be glory forever and ever. Amen.
The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
A reading from the Holy Gospel according to Luke.
Glory to you, Lord.
Jesus addressed this parable to those who were convinced of their own righteousness and despised everyone else. Two people went up to the temple area to pray. One is a Pharisee and the other a tax collector. The Pharisee took up his position and spoke this prayer to himself. O God, I thank you that I'm not like the rest of humanity. Greedy, dishonest, adulterous, or even like this tax collector. I fast twice a week, and I pay tithes on my whole income. But the tax collector stood off at a distance. He would not even raise his eyes to heaven, but beat his breast and prayed. O God, be merciful to me, a sinner. I tell you, the latter went home justified, not the former. For whoever exalts himself will be humbled, and the one who humbles himself will be exalted. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
Christ.
There's one thing that Jesus loves to do. He loves going after the big sinners. For a moment, think about water. Water is amazing in what it can do, and one of its amazing properties is how it always seeks out the lowest place to go. You know, if your roof has a hole in it, it doesn't leak right where it comes in. The water's going to travel around until it finds the lowest spot. That's just how water works. And that's how God's grace works as well. It's seeking out the lowest of the low. It's seeking out those who are sinners all the time, yes. But especially it seeks out the most hardened sinner of all. And Jesus went after those big sinners. He didn't go after them to destroy them. He went after them because he loved them and he wanted to convert them. He wanted to win them over to his friendship. St. Luke, our gospel writer, tells us that Jesus addressed this parable to those who were convinced of their own righteousness and despised everyone else. Words for us all to ponder. Words in a culture that too often says, I'm okay and you're okay, and that's good enough to get me into heaven. It's not going to get us into heaven. It's our own self-righteousness then that's getting in the way. The big sinners. That's who Jesus is going after. You know, one of the amazing things about the saints, and I've been reading a lot of saint stories lately, and without exception, every one of those saints thought that they were the worst sinners in the world. They thought they were the worst sinners in the world. Do you think you're the worst sinner in the world? Do I think I'm the worst sinner in the world? And yet those saints all believed they were the worst sinners in the world. Some might argue and say, well, they had some deep-seated psychological issues then for feeling that way. Well, guess what? I'd rather be in that boat because they're in heaven right now. And right now I'm not. So if you want to label any of us that, go right ahead. I'd rather be in heaven where it's safe. The big sinners, the ones that Jesus is speaking about in the gospel, it's because their hearts were poisoned with that little thing we call arrogance. We've all been infected by it at some time or other. People who are arrogant look down on other people. They consider themselves superior, better, holier. Whatever word you want to use. But if you really think about it, that's exactly the same thing the devil does. He rebelled against God. Why? Because he thought he was better than God. And what's worse, people who tend to be arrogant don't even see their sinfulness. They recognize it nowhere. And so is that the kind of person that maybe we should avoid, I suppose. But Jesus doesn't, does he? He tells this parable specifically in order to reel those people into his heart, to make them see the folly of their ugliness, of that self-centered lifestyle they're living, and he's reaching out to them. Jesus didn't just preach to the choir. Certainly would have been much safer to do that. He would not have ruffled any feathers, made any powerful enemies, and he would never have been put to death. And so, in his eagerness to bring sinners to the light, he shows how much he loves and how much he cares about others, and how little he really worried about himself. If his priority had been comfortable self-satisfaction, he would never have gone after any of them. But thank the Lord, he did go after them, and he's still going after them, each and every one of us, because Jesus wants absolutely everyone to come to his Father's house in heaven. The Catechism of the Catholic Church summarizes this truth with a very beautiful sentence very early in the paragraph number 30. Although man can forget God or reject him, God never ceases to call every man to seek him so as to find life and happiness. Most of us maybe never heard of this person. His name was Dr. Bernard Nathanson. And yet he's infamous and famous, I suppose. First of all, he was an atheist. And no one did more than to legalize abortion in this country than him. Way back in the 1960s, he and a handful of collaborators set to work to legalize abortion. What they did is unthinkable. Makes you wonder how much more of this is going on in this political crazy climate of our world today. But way back then in the 60s, they fabricated statistical studies. They leveraged the mass media, lobbied in Washington, and mounted a legal strategy that manipulated abused women. That's a fact. You can check it yourself. They used every means available, both moral and immoral, to create the climate in which the Supreme Court could make its infamous Roe versus Wade a law of the land. And since then, 1973, there's been almost 50 million human lives lost because of that law. And 75,000 of those abortions were done by Dr. Nathanson himself. In a book in 1996, Dr. Nathanson, his book's called The Hand of God, he tells how it all happened. He tells also what happened after his campaign succeeded in 1973. You see, a little while later, an invention came about, the invention of the ultrasound. And it enabled him to see what really happens inside the womb during an abortion. After that, he stopped performing abortions. And soon after that, he actually became a pro-life activist. But he could not sleep at night. His guilt was eating away at him. He would wake up in a cold sweat, haunted by the lives that he had ended, directly and indirectly. He then began to think about following in the footsteps of his grandfather and his sister by committing suicide. He just could not live with himself. He needed to wash away his sins. And in his book, he says that he could not find any way to do it. At that point in his life, a very critical one, he witnessed a pro-life demonstration outside an abortion clinic in New York City. And there was the moment of grace. He saw the people praying. He saw their faith and their peace. And then he began to think that there just might be hope for himself. A priest reached out to him, and soon afterwards, in 1996, Dr. Bernard Nathanson, former abortionist and abortion rights activist, was baptized, and his sins were forgiven, all of them. Yes, Jesus really loves going after the big sinners. And if Jesus goes after the big sinners, maybe we should too. You know, some people naturally like taking risks. They spend their free time in hand gliding and jumping out of airplanes with parachutes and bungee jumping, rock climbing. Other people naturally avoid taking risks. They spend their vacations sipping flavored coffee and reading bestsellers. But there's no one risk. There's one risk that no one likes to take. And that's the risk of being rejected. It is this fear of being rejected, looked down upon, judged, laughed at, that blocks us from reaching out to the big sinners around us. And yet that is exactly the risk that Jesus took when he came into this world. And as we well know, it actually didn't work out too well for him, did it? He did end up rejected, condemned, lied about, publicly humiliated, tortured, abandoned, betrayed, and crucified. But he took the risk willingly because saving sinners mattered so much to him. Every week we come here, most of us, to receive our Lord in the Eucharist, Holy Communion. We receive into our lives, hearts, our very bodies, Christ himself, his life, his heart, his body, his blood. Every week he nourishes our souls so that we can become more and more like him, little by little. And this is because he wants to continue reaching out to all sinners, big sinners and small sinners, to continue to take the risk of rejection. And he wants to do it through us, to give us a share in that saving mission. Only in Christ can we be strong enough to take that risk of rejection, of reaching out to people who need Christ the most, to those who maybe have had abortions. They need to experience Jesus' healing love. Those who struggle with same-sex attractions. The relative who hasn't been to Mass in maybe 20 or 30 years. Or maybe even a friend right now who's contemplating suicide. Christ wants every single one of them and so many more to discover his love and his friendship. And he's asking us to give him a hand to make it happen. So let's not be afraid. Pray to the Holy Spirit. Let him move you, and then we will do it. In Christ's name, amen. We now stand and profess our faith as we say together, I believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all things visible and invisible. I believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, born of the Father before all ages, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, consubstantial with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us men and for our salvation, he came down from heaven. The Holy Spirit was incarnate of the Virgin Mary and became man. For our sake he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried, and rose again on the third day in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is adored and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. I believe in one holy Catholic and apostolic church. I confess one baptism for the forgiveness of sins, and I look forward to the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. God hears the prayers of those who humbly present their needs, and so we now pray, and our response is, Lord, hear our prayer. Lord, hear our prayer.
For our church leaders and for all missionaries who give their lives to spread the good news, may their humble and prayerful efforts bring hope and renewal to our world, we pray.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For all citizens, as we prayerfully reflect and prepare for the election of our next president, may the Holy Spirit be our guide, we pray.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For peace and justice in our community and throughout the world, and for safety for those who work for peace in hostile places, we pray.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For the courage to be humble in a world that values self-promotion and personal success, we pray.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For the marginalized and the forgotten in our community and beyond, for the continued support for those who pray and work with them, we pray.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For the living and deceased members of Most Blessed Sacrament Parish, for intentions in our prayer books and on our prayer line, and for the intentions we hold in our hearts, we pray.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For Valdi Baron, who has gone before us, marked with a sign of faith, and all of our loved ones who have died. In particular, we pray for Marge Lett, Patricia Hiltz, and Orville and Josephine Hiltz. May they be granted eternal rest, we pray.
Lord, hear our prayer. O God, you are merciful to sinners who cry out to you. Hear these our prayers that we might one day be exalted with you in heaven. We ask this through Christ our Lord. Amen.
Thank you.
O Lord, give me life according to your word. Give me discernment that I may know your decrees. Give me discernment that I may know your decrees. Brothers and sisters, that my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God, the Almighty Father.
May the Lord accept the sacrifice at your hands for the praise and glory of his name, for our good and the good of all of his holy church.
Almighty, look, we pray, O Lord, on the offerings we make to your majesty, that whatever is done by us in your service may be directed above all to your glory, through Christ our Lord. Amen. The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lift up your hearts.
Lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right and just.
It is truly right to give you thanks, truly just to give you glory, Father most holy, for you are the one God, living and true, existing before all ages, abiding for all eternity, dwelling in unapproachable light. Yet you, who alone are good, the source of all life, have made all that is, so that you might fill your creatures with blessings and bring joy to many of them by the glory of your light. And so, in your presence, our countless host of angels who serve you day and night, and gazing upon the glory of your face, glorify you without ceasing. With them, we too confess your name in exaltation, giving voice to every creature under heaven, as we acclaim.
Holy, holy, holy Lord God of hosts, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. In the highest. Hosanna in the highest. Hosanna in the highest. Hosanna in the highest.
we give you praise, Father most holy. For you are great, and you have fashioned all your works in wisdom and in love. You formed man in your own image, and entrusted the whole world to his care, so that in serving you alone, the Creator, he might have dominion over all creatures. And when through disobedience he had lost your friendship, you did not abandon him to the domain of death, for you came in mercy to the aid of all, so that those who seek might find you. Time and again you offer them covenants, and through the prophets taught them to look forward to salvation. And you so love the world, Father most holy, that in the fullness of time you sent your only begotten Son to be our Savior, made incarnate by the Holy Spirit. Born of the Virgin Mary, he shared our human nature in all things but sin. To the poor he proclaimed the good news of salvation, to prisoners freedom, to the sorrowful of heart joy. And to accomplish your plan, he gave himself up to death, and by rising from the dead, he destroyed death and restored life, and that we might live no longer for ourselves, but for him who died and rose again for us. He sent the Holy Spirit from you, Father, as the first fruits for those who believe, so that bringing to perfection his work in the world, he might sanctify creation to the full. Therefore, O Lord, we pray, may this same Holy Spirit graciously sanctify these offerings, that they may become the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ, for the celebration of this great mystery which he himself left us as an eternal covenant. For when the hour had come for him to be glorified by you, Father most holy, having loved his own who were in the world, he loved them to the end. And while they were at supper, he took bread, blessed, and broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, taking the chalice filled with the fruit of the vine, he gave thanks and gave the chalice to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me."
The mystery of faith.
When we eat this bread and drink this cup, we proclaim your death, O Lord, until you come again. Until you come again.
Therefore, O Lord, as we now celebrate the memorial of our redemption, we remember Christ's death and his descent to the realm of the dead. We proclaim his resurrection and his ascension to your right hand. And as we await his coming in glory, we offer you his body and blood, the sacrifice acceptable to you, which brings salvation to the whole world. Look, O Lord, upon the sacrifice which you yourself have provided for your church, and grant in your loving kindness to all who partake of this one bread and one chalice, that gathered into one body by the Holy Spirit, they may truly become a living sacrifice in Christ to the praise of your glory. Therefore, Lord, remember now all for whom we offer this sacrifice, especially your servant Francis, our Pope, David, our Bishop, and the whole order of bishops, all the clergy, those who take part in this offering, those gathered here before you, your entire people, and all who seek you with a sincere heart. Remember also those who have died in the peace of your Christ and all the dead whose faith you alone have known. To all of us, your children, grant, O merciful Father, that we may enter into a heavenly inheritance with the Blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, with Blessed Joseph, her spouse, and with your apostles and saints in your kingdom. There, with the whole of creation, freed from the corruption of sin and death, we may glorify you through Christ our Lord, through whom you bestow on the world all that is good.
Through him, and with him, and in him, O God, Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours forever and ever.
Savior's command, and form of divine teaching, we dare to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy, we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ.
The kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever.
Lord Jesus Christ, who said to your apostles, Peace I leave you, my peace I give you. Look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever.
Amen.
The peace of the Lord be with you always.
And with your spirit.
Now let us offer each other a sign of peace.
Behold the Lamb of God. Behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb. Lord, I am not worthy that you should enter under my roof, but only say the word and my soul shall be healed. We will ring out our joy at your saving help and exult in the name of our God. And exult in the name of our God.
Amen. Please be seated. This time we'll have our second collection. Prayer to St. Michael. St. Michael, the Archangel, defend us in battle. Be our defense against the wickedness and snares of the devil. May God rebuke him, we humbly pray. And do thou, O Prince of the heavenly host, by the power of God, thrust into hell Satan and all the evil spirits, prowl about the world, seeking the ruin of souls. Amen. Let us pray. May your sacraments, O Lord, we pray, perfect in us what lies within them, that what we now celebrate in signs, we may one day possess in truth through Christ our Lord. Amen. And the Lord be with you. May Almighty God bless you, Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen. Go and announce the gospel of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Though the mountains may fall and the hills turn to dust, yet the love of the Lord will stand as a shelter for all who will call on his name. Sing the praise and the glory of God. Could the Lord ever leave you? Could the Lord forget his love? Though a mother forsake her child, he will not abandon you. Though the mountains may fall and the hills turn to dust, yet the love of the Lord will stand as a shelter for